Hello, my name is Dr. Ibrahimian, and in this channel I go over problems from math competitions. This is a problem from the IMC, International Math Competition for University Students, from 2025. This is problem number 2, and this competition was held a few days ago. So they gave us a function that is twice continuously differentiable, and they gave us two conditions, which one of them is that if integral of f from negative 1 to 1 is 0, and the other one is f of 1 and f of negative 1 are both 1. And we want to show that the integral from negative 1 to 1 of f double prime squared is at least 15. And they are also asking us to find all functions that the equality holds. Now, if you have some experience with math competitions and inequalities, you must have seen the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. And this is kind of like screams the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. So what is the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality? The Cauchy-Schwarz inequality in general tells us that the inner product of u and v for every two vectors in an inner product space is at most magnitude of u times magnitude of v. This is the general form of the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, and I can even put absolute value on the left side. If you're not familiar with inner product, you might be familiar with the dot product in Rn, or at least in R3. And the way we evaluate the dot product in R3 or Rn is you take the product of the norms of the two vectors, or length of two vectors, times cosine of the angle in between. And of course, if you take absolute value of that, because cosine is between 1 and negative 1, this is less than or equal to magnitude of u, or norm of u, times norm of v. Now, if you look at continuous functions, you can define an inner product over continuous functions, in this case, from the interval from negative 1 to 1 to r. And the inner product is defined as the integral from negative 1 to 1 of f of x, g of x, dx. This is for functions. F and g are functions from negative 1 to 1 to r, and they are continuous functions. So what is the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality in this case? So if you look at the inner product of a function with itself, so f dot f, which is the magnitude or norm of f squared, this is the integral from negative 1 to 1 of f of x squared dx, which is very similar to the left side of this inequality. So bottom line is this: if I take the inner product of f double prime and any continuous function, this is less than or equal to magnitude of f double prime, magnitude of g. And I can take the absolute value of that. Now, if we rewrite this one in the form that the inner product that we know, we're going to get this. The integral from negative 1 to 1, f double prime g, is equal to, I guess it's less than or equal to, and these are the magnitudes, so you have to take the square root of that expression that I wrote up there. So this is the square root from negative 1 to 1 of f double prime squared dx, integral from negative 1 to 1, g squared dx. So this screams that this might be a useful inequality, because on this side we have exactly the expression that they gave us. So let's rewrite this one and see if that helps. So we have the integral from negative 1 to 1 of f of x, f double prime of x squared dx, times the integral from negative 1 to 1 of g of x squared dx is greater than or equal to integral from negative 1 to 1 of f double prime of x, g of x, dx. Well, all of that must be squared. Now, of course, we want to find the minimum of this expression. Now, this inequality holds for every function g, for every continuous function g. So if you pick a continuous function, this is a fixed value. We can evaluate this one, and this does not depend on f. If we can find something that this side also becomes independent of f, we are likely going to be able to solve the problem. So let's look at the right side and see what we have. So integral from negative 1 to 1 of f double prime of g, f double prime of x, gx dx. Well, this is basically screaming that this is an integration part problem, an integration by part problem. So this would be our dv, and this would be our u. So we can write this down as f prime of x, g of x, from negative 1 to 1, minus integral from negative 1 to 1 of f prime of x, g prime of x, dx. Okay, so this is what we get. So now, we are going to be able to simplify this one. So let's plug in 1, we get f prime of 1, which we don't really know anything about, g of 1, which we don't know also anything about, minus f prime of negative 1, g of negative 1. But remember that this g is completely arbitrary, so we can choose g anything that we want, anything that is continuous, minus. Now we can apply the integration by parts to this one as well. So this would be f of x. We can do f of x g prime of x, and then plus f of x g, or I guess this would be from negative 1 to 1. Now it becomes minus minus, because I'm using integration by parts, integral from negative 1 to 1, and we're going to get f of x g double prime of x dx. So remember that we were trying to come up with some g that makes this expression independent of f. Well, let's look at the assumptions that they gave us. One of the assumptions was integral of f is 0. And there were two other assumptions about f of 1 and f of negative 1. So we can replace f of 1 and f of negative 1 by 1. So this would be f prime of 1, g of 1, minus f prime of negative 1, g of negative 1 minus f of 1, g prime of 1, plus f of negative 1, g prime of negative 1. And then plus the integral from negative 1 to 1, f of x, g double prime of x. Well, this is really nice, because what we can do is we can choose g in a way that this becomes integral from negative 1 to 1 of f of x dx, maybe with some scalar here. So if we choose g in a way that its second derivative is constant, then we can just replace this one by 0. Well, what g should we choose? Well, we can choose g to be any quadratic, because second derivative of a quadratic function becomes a constant. So we're going to choose g of x to be a quadratic. Now, what else is the obstacle in solving the problem? Well, first of all, this guy is 1. This guy is also 1. Now, in order to make this whole side independent of f, I would like to get rid of this whole thing. So how would I get rid of this whole thing? Notice that g prime of 1 and g prime of negative 1 are given. Whatever g that we choose, that's going to be whatever we get. So we can choose our g to make this one vanish, because we don't really know what f prime of 1 and f prime of negative 1 are. So a natural choice for g is to make sure that g of 1 and g of negative 1 are negative 1. So we're going to are 0. So we're going to choose g that g of 1 and g of negative 1 are 0, and g is quadratic. So it becomes more and more clear what we should do. So we're going to choose g of x to be x squared minus 1. Then this is a quadratic, and it has two roots of negative 1 and 1. So now let's rewrite the inequality that we have. So we have f double prime squared dx integral from negative 1 to 1 of x squared minus 1 squared dx. This is greater than or equal to integral from negative 1 to 1 of f double prime of x, x squared minus 1, dx, all squared. And we computed this side, and we ended up with this expression that we got. F prime of 1 times g of 1 minus f prime of negative 1 times g of negative 1. So that all is 0 minus 1 times g prime of 1. What is g prime of 1? Well, g prime is 2x. So g prime of 1 is 2. So we have 2. The other one is g prime of negative 1. What is g prime of negative 1? G prime of negative 1 is also negative 2. So we get negative 2 here. And then The final term is plus integral of f times the second derivative of g, which is 2. And that becomes 2 times 0, which is just 0. So plus 0. All of that squared. So what is that? That's 4 squared. That's 16. So let's now evaluate this one. And that should give us the answer. So we have integral from negative 1 to 1, f double prime of x squared dx. Integral from negative 1 to 1, x to the 4th minus 2x squared plus 1 dx is greater than or equal to 16. Let's evaluate this middle term and see what we get. So integral from negative 1 to 1 of x to the 4th minus 2x squared plus 1 dx is equal to x to the 5th over 5th over 5 minus 2x cubed over 3 plus x from negative 1 to 1. So this would be 2 fifths. Minus, if we plug in 1 and negative 1, we get 4 thirds, and then we get plus 2. Let's take the common denominator of 15. We get 6 minus 20 plus 30. So this becomes 16 over 15. So let's take that and plug it into the inequality. We get negative 1 to 1, f double prime, f of x squared, dx times 5 is 16. Over 15, that is greater than or equal to 16. So clearing the denominator, dividing by 16, we get exactly what we want. Now, there was also a second part to this problem, which was, when does the equality hold? So when does the equality hold in Cauchy-Schwarz inequality? So equality holds in Cauchy-Schwarz inequality when, so this one is equal to product of the magnitudes. When does this hold? When the angle between them, so I'm going to explain the intuitive reason, and of course there's also a full justification, a complete proof for that. So when does that hold? When cosine of theta, which is the angle in between u and v, is equal to 1 or negative 1. So when does that happen? That happens if u and v are scalar multiples, if u and v are multiples. So in this case, when does the equality hold? So the equality hold when the two functions that we wrote, one of them was f double prime of x, and the other one was x squared minus 1. These two functions that we used in this inequality are scalar multiples of each other. So this would be equal to c times x squared minus 1. Now, from here, we can evaluate f of x. So f of x would be, we can integrate this one, c x to the 4th over 12, because we have to divide by 3 and then we have to divide by 4, minus c x squared over 2. But then, because we are taking an integral, we have also ax plus b at the end. Now we have the two conditions that they gave us. Integral from negative 1 to 1 of f of x dx would have to be 0. So this means, let's integrate this. So we have c x to the 5th over 60 minus c x cubed over 6 plus a x squared over 2 plus bx from negative 1 to 1 is 0. Let's plug in the values. We get 2c over 60 minus 2c over 6 plus, well, that term is just 0, and then plus 2b. So this is going to be 0. Let's take the simplify this. This is c over 30 minus c over 3 plus 2b equals 0. Let us clear the denominator, so we get c minus 10c plus 60b equals 0. So we get minus 9c plus 60b equals 0. So we get c is equal to 20 over 3b. So we get that. And then we have two other conditions. We have f of 1 and f of negative 1 would have to be 1. So we get, let's take f of 1. F of 1 is c over 12 minus c over 2 plus a plus b that would have to be 1. We have c over 12 minus c over 2 minus a plus b would have to also be 1. So we can add these, and if we add these, we get c over 6 minus c plus 2b equals 2. That would give us minus 5c over 6 plus 2b equals 2. We can replace c by 20 over 3, so we get minus 5 over 6 times 20 over 3b plus 2b equals 2. And from here, we can solve for b. So we get 6, 3, that's 10, minus 50 over 9b plus 2b equals 2. So this gives us minus 50b plus 18b equals 18. And from here, we can get b, we can get c after that, and eventually a is also 0. So from here, we can get that a is 0. So that gives us the function that, in fact, gives us the equality. And that brings me to the end of this video. I will see you in the next video.